and she would pick up Jacob, which is about an hour and 15 minutes away, and she would take him and keep him for the weekend. And man, what a gift that was for us as new parents. And then we had Cameron about 2.5 years later. And Linda would come down every month or so, and she would take both of them, you know, and keep them. And incredible gift. Then we had Trevor, and then Linda would come every 3 or 4 months or something. And she would take all three of them. And then we had our fourth one, Nathan. We never saw Linda for a long, long time. Everybody has their limits. But I remember thinking, I don't think Tracy and I purchased the first pair of shoes for our kids until Jacob was about 12 years old. Just incredible giver. Incredible. Many may not know this, but Linda spent time in foster care as a child, and that had to be incredibly traumatic for her. But she spoke of the wonderful people and the wonderful experiences she had in the various homes that she spent time in. And what we would call a tragedy, Linda spoke of with affection. And God redeemed that traumatic experience. And she raised two kids who are both passionate about fostering and adoption. And so once again, we are so thankful to God for Linda and the work that he did in her life. But our greatest reason for gratitude is Linda's faith in Jesus. She was instrumental in her family, and Tracy soon followed, and Hall, and of course Sid. I remember it was early on that you came to faith in Christ. And now there's generations of faith in Christ because of Linda. So we're most grateful for Jesus Christ. Because without Jesus, this would be a tragedy. But because of Jesus, this is an incredible day of victory.
Amen.
And of celebration. Because as Paul said, it's through faith in Christ that we are made right with God. And as Jesus said, we may die here, but we will never die again. We will live in eternity now with Jesus. And so here's what we know. Linda is with Jesus.
Yes.
Linda lives. Linda worships. Linda celebrates. Linda laughs. Linda's enjoying the faithfulness of Jesus Christ. And for that, we are so grateful. Father God, we're so grateful once again to you. And Lord, we've been blessed in so many ways through one person. We've been blessed in so many ways. So thankful, God, to you. So thankful for her. And so, God, now as we continue through this service, Lord, we do it with a heart of gratitude and, Father, with a heart of worship. And we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I'm the one she saw every weekend. In the winter of 2009, Grant Heslov's The Men Who Stare at Goats at theaters nationwide. The movie starred Ewan McGregor, George Clooney, Kevin Spacey, and Jeff Bridges. It was met with mixed reviews. Variety called it a superbly written Looney Tunes satire, and Entertainment Weekly called it a film about nothing but its own smugness. It was a movie about a special unit in the U.S. Army who could use paranormal powers using solely their brains. It was a movie about a special unit in the U.S. Army who took large amounts of LSD. Drugs. Not a lot of people saw this movie, but other people who did see it, I guarantee you the percentage of them who were grandson-grandmother combos was almost 0%. I say almost zero because Gammy and I went to see this movie together. Gammy said I would never miss a movie with George Clooney. Sorry, Papa. I said, same girl, same. I'm sorry, Kimberly. I moved in with my grandparents, my Gammy, my Papa, in late 2009. I stayed for a few months. For most of our relationships, I believe we're singly tethered to one another. However, I believe we can be doubly tethered to one another. It's just more difficult. For most of our friends, we're tethered by like. And for most of our family members, we're tethered by love. Both are important, I think. And those of us who are lucky may eventually throw out the love tether to our friends and the life tether to our family. These relationships, the ones with our family members, are already lifelong relationships. But when we throw out the life tether, we're saying, hey, I know I didn't choose to love you, but I would have chosen you if I got the chance. Because by golly, I like him to love you. You guys are supposed to make me so nervous I can't cry, and you're doing a poor job. It's probably easiest to like love our siblings, perhaps second easiest to like love our parents. And I think for most, it's pretty difficult to like love our grandparents. We're separated by so many years, by so many different experiences, and sometimes there's even an actual spatial separation. Moving in with Gammy and Papa was a true blessing for me because during this time I became doubly tethered to both of them. Allergies. They became more than just the grandparents I'd always loved. They became people I truly liked and enjoyed. My grandfather became someone I could enjoy just hanging out with. My grandmother became someone I could go see an irreverent comedy. Goodness gracious. Sorry, guys. It's going to be a long one. I'd like to share a conversation with you that I had with Gammy when I was living with them. Gammy, hey, Jacob, you know I just love you, and you will always be my first grandbaby. This isn't sugar-coated, I promise. This is literally how Gammy talked and what she talked about. Me, yes, ma'am, and I love you too, and I'll always be your favorite. I'm not going to tell you today that it was her favorite. I'll tell you she didn't deny it. Gammy, are you hungry? Can I get you something to eat? Me, no thank you. Gammy, are you sure? What about something to drink? Are you thirsty? Me, no thank you, I'm okay. Gammy, there's ice cream in the freezer. Moose Tracks, your favorite. How about I make you a bowl? No thank you, I'm really not hungry. What about a sandwich? I might make one myself. I got some really good turkey. No thank you, Gammy. I also have some of those IBC root beers. Do you want a root beer? No, thank you. Don't tell your mom, but I can make us some cocktails. Does that sound good? No, I could just run over to Kroger real quick and get us food. Is there anything that sounds good? No, thank you. Nothing I can think of. What about a glass of water? No, thank you. No, thank you. We can run up to Dairy Queen. No, thank you. I really am good. From another room in the house, Papa. Linda! Leave him alone. He doesn't need anything. Gammy, I'm just going to make us some sandwiches. As Americans living in today's world, I think we're incredibly blessed human beings, and I think every one of us would readily admit this. The American blessing, I believe, is we have everything we need, and we have most everything we want. Too often, though, I don't think we talk about the American curse. The American curse is we have everything we need, and we have most everything we want. As a man raised with the American curse, I too often feel and act like a spoiled boy. There are two things I always struggle with due to this curse. Number one, this part's not even sad. I don't even know where I go. Number one, not living in the moment. And number two, not letting Jesus love me. As a spoiled boy who has everything I need and most everything I want, this hurts. It's hard to comprehend when suddenly somebody you need and want is gone. We act like we know none of us will live here on earth forever, but when suddenly someone in your life to whom you are doubly tethered, someone who has only loved and adored you, and served you your entire life, is taken away, it sometimes feels like I'm going to fall. I understand that Gammy is in no more pain. I understand that for the first time in the history of Gammy, Gammy is now truly alive and perfect and everlasting. And that is good, and I recognize that good, and I'm thankful for that good. But here, in this moment, in my moment, I hurt. But I'm learning that that's good too. There's only one thing in this life on earth that we're guaranteed. It isn't 70 years or 24 hours or sickness or health or happiness or sadness. The only thing we have is right now. It's so easy to miss out on the moments, on the now, and ironically, I do it all the time. It would be easiest to miss out on many of these hard moments, these moments that hurt. It would be easier right now to mindlessly scroll on my phone, or to distract myself with television or video games, or to bury myself in work, or to deflect conversation with jokes. Gammy was so good at passionately living in the moment. I think it would be disrespectful for her, to her, for us to do otherwise. I have zero memories of Gammy tuning me out by looking at her phone or watching television. If Gammy was in the room with you, she was wholly focused on you. She was so perfect at sharing her now with whomever she was with. A couple of years ago, my wife lost her sister. But just a few months ago, Gammy told me about her experience when Christy passed. Gammy was in surgery, unconscious, when it happened. And when she woke up, she was told of Christy's passing. And she told me, "Jacob, I thought I was going to cry myself to death." Gammy barely even knew Christy. But Gammy had shared moments with Christy. And because of that, Gammy had truly lived in her now with Christy. And Gammy loved me and my wife so much that her love extended even to those who we love. And because of that, there was Gammy, her world getting rapidly more painful and confusing by the day. And yet she set aside space to feel for me and my wife and for Christy. I believe each of us would benefit from living more like Gammy, by living in the moment, even when the moment hurts. Gammy lived an incredibly valuable life because of her choice to always be present. I'm learning that when we can set aside our distractions and our walls and our biases and really love and really live in this moment that we all share, it's inevitable for us to love one another and be loved by others. I don't think we can truly love when not sharing this moment that we're all in together. Our Bibles are filled with verses about feeding the hungry and quenching the thirst of the thirsty. And I've never known anyone as desperate to feed and give water to as Gammy was. If everyone in the world had a Gammy, starvation would end in the blink of an eye. But as a spoiled boy with the American curse, I failed to appreciate Gammy's love as much as I wish I did now. I lived with Gammy and Papa during a very dark time in my life. I'm a private person, and I didn't share those hardships with them or anyone at the time, but I always knew that Gammy somehow knew. And as much as I didn't want to let her in, Gammy never stopped trying to shine a light in my darkness. She never stopped trying to be the Jesus I needed. She never stopped loving me when I needed it most. She never stopped trying to feed me or quench my thirst. I too often remind myself of Peter when he tried to stop Jesus from being Jesus. Jesus got on his knees to wash Peter's feet, and Peter told Jesus, "No, you shall never wash my feet." Too many times I told Gammy no when she tried to be my Jesus. And I'm so sorry, Gammy. And I'm so thirsty today. But let us not forget all the reasons why Jesus wanted to wash his disciples' feet. And let us not forget all the lessons to be learned from Gammy trying to feed us. Yes, Jesus and Gammy both truly loved the people they shared their now with. And we all need to be loved. We all need to let Jesus and our Gammies love us. We also need to learn to love the people we live with. We need to be the Christ to the people in our moment. We need to be the Gammy to the people in our moment. You are here because, yes, you've been affected by Gammy's death, but only because you've been more affected by our love. You have been more affected by our love. Appreciate that love. Love that love. And don't forget the lessons in that love. I understand how dark this moment can feel, but the world's a brighter place because Gammy went to him. So let's continue to light up the dark. Thank you.
Bella Fleming. I'm one of Linda's granddaughters, and this is my mom, Eric Rebecca. But I wanted to share a letter I wrote for Mimi in honor of her. For my grandmother, my twin flame, and one of my best friends, I love you so much, and I treasure every moment we spent together. You made my life beautiful, filled with color, hope, and love, and I could come to you with anything, and you would always offer me your shoulder. You gave endless and incredible love, and every smile and every hug is embedded in my heart, as it is for all of us, and every story and every experience I treasure and I keep close. Your sweet voice I cherish. I love how much you truly and deeply love those around you, your family, your friends, animals, shopping, music, fashion, and the Lord. Everywhere we went, a stranger would always say to you, "I just love you." That love you carried and lived was such a beautiful mirroring of the incredible love that Father has for us. One that has no end, one that brings safety, joy, peace, and comfort. I miss you more than anything, as we all do, and we all will. And though here, it will never be the same without you, I know that heaven now has one of the most incredible, beautiful, intelligent, kind, and gentle, loving souls to bring even more glory to our Heavenly Father. And one day we all get to experience it with you, and what a blessing and honor that is and will be. And as I would always say, I love you to the moon and back, and you would always reply, "I love you to the galaxies and the stars beyond." Love you, Mimi. Thank you.
Cameron, and this is my wife Krista, and you've heard her referred to as Gammy and Mimi by Isabella right here. I'm the one who came up with the name Wawa, and I'm proud of it, because to three-year-old me, that name made sense, but kids are crazy. So this is a song that is true for all of God's children, but it's especially true for Wawa right now. God is my shepherd, I won't be wanting, I won't be wanting. He makes me rest in fields of green and quiet streams. He makes me rise. fields of green, quiet stream. Death and dying, I will not fear that you are with me. You're always with me. A shepherd's staff comforts me. You are my feet. House of God forever. The house of God forever. The house of God forever.
Thank you, Jesus.
When Linda was suffering in her last few weeks, Sid called me and asked about if I would be willing to do a part of Linda's service. And I said, Sid, I'm humbled and I'd be honored. And since that time, I've been thinking, what would be appropriate Bible verses to use? And I couldn't help but come up with two. One you've heard, as Cam and Krista sang, the 23rd Psalm. I'll be reading that in a moment. But this verse kept coming back to mind, a great section of scripture that I think defines Linda Fleming. It comes from the book of Proverbs, chapter 31, beginning with verse 10, and I'll read various verses from that. The writer says, an excellent wife, who can find? For her worth is far above jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not evil all the days of her life. She rises while it's still night and gives food to her household and portions to her maidens. She extends her hand to the poor and she stretches out her hands to the needy. She is not afraid of the snow for her household, for all her households are clothed with scarlet. She makes covering for herself. Her clothing is fine linen, purple. She makes linen garments and sells them and supplies belts to the tradesmen. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she smiles at the future. She opens her mouth in wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and bless her. Her husband also. And he praises her, saying, many daughters have done nobly, but you excel them all. Charm is deceitful, and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we've gathered here today to worship you, give you praise, glory. But we've also come to give honor to the life and memory of Linda Fleming. God, I pray that your spirit will move among us today. In his name I pray. There was a hospice nurse who once shared with me about a saline solution that's used to help heal certain wounds in our bodies. But she also went on to say that the same ingredients in that saline solution could be found in our tears. As Scott and Jacob came, they almost apologized for weeping. But let's not be sorry for our tears. That's just normal. In fact, in Psalms 58, this is what the psalmist wrote. You have kept a record of my days of misery. You have stored my tears in your bottle and counted each one. So yes, we'll weep. This is a time of sadness in some ways, but that's okay. We'll grieve because death has invaded a family's life. It's taken a wife, mother, grandmother, a friend. But in 1 Thessalonians 4:13, Paul says, yes, we'll grieve, but not as those who have no hope. We don't like to think about death and dying, but it's going to happen to all of us. In Hebrews 9:27, it says, it's appointed unto man once to die. As one writer once said, death waits for all of us, like a concrete floor waits for a falling light bulb. We're not here to mourn Linda's death, though. We're here to celebrate her life, a life of love, a life of loyalty to the Lord and to her family. And Linda Fleming didn't exist for 75 years. She felt and filled every one of those years with life and with living. David writes the very familiar Psalms that we all should know by heart. Psalms 23, he writes, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his namesake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You have prepared a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Truly goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever."
Yes.
I believe there are three truths that David gives us in this Psalms that can apply to all of us today. Number one, the Lord is our provider and sustainer in life. It's in those green pastures and still waters that we find that God always meets our needs. And he's promised to do that in every area of life. Even he has promised us to meet our needs when it comes to hope and strength and comfort and the peace of his presence. God has met many of your needs in Linda. Sid, a loving wife, 54 years. And as Sid and I were talking one day, he said, you know, Linda was born 20 days before me, so that makes her older than me, and I never let her forget. She was your helpmate. She was your partner, your best friend. Even in the times of struggle, you knew that God was working. And you shared so many things together. You shared a strong faith together. Love, children, grandchildren, a zest for life and living. And Sid shared this with me, a very beautiful moment, Jacob said. During her last days here on earth, Linda was lying in their bed one evening. Sid walked in and just lay down beside her, reached over and held her. Turned on some music. The music was some old traditional church hymns that Linda loved. And as he was there holding his precious wife, Sid said, "Those songs I knew touched her, and they touched me. They ministered to me." Paul, Tracy, you had an awesome mother. She disciplined you when you deserved it and showed you all kinds of grace when you needed it. There's an old Southern saying, she raised you right, you know? But think about it, all the values, all those important things in life that she taught you, you have been passing on to your children and your grandchildren. And to all her grandchildren and great-grandchildren, she gave you so much love. It was George Bernard Shaw who wrote, "Life is no brief candle to me. It is a splendid torch which I've got a hold of for just a moment. And I want to pass it on and or make it burn as brightly as possible before passing it on to future generations." Well, Linda did that. Her life was this burning torch of faith and commitment to the Lord, and she's passed it on to every one of you. And to those of us who knew Linda, what a sweet, humble woman of God. In those years at First Christian Church, when we were all serving together, I still remember Linda never wanted to be in the spotlight. She never pushed herself to be there, but she was always faithful. always working behind the scenes. John Maxwell, in one of his books, says leadership is influence, nothing more and nothing less. With that in mind, I'm going to ask you as a congregation, and I want the family to turn around in just a second, but if Linda Fleming has influenced you, has touched your life in any way, would you stand? Thank you. You can be seated. And to those of us who knew Linda, her name means gentle, soft,
yes,
kind-hearted, with nurturing quality. That really describes Linda, doesn't it? In fact, in the Spanish language, it means beautiful. I can still remember the time that Sid and Linda and my wife and I took a trip down to Callaway Gardens. Sid is a pilot, and he would take me flying all the time. I'd love that. But the four of us got in a Cessna 140-170 out of the airport, and flew down to Callaway Gardens, and spent the day there in Pine Mountain, Georgia. And just had a wonderful time, ate lunch there, and saw the scenery around. And this was a Saturday afternoon, about 5 o'clock, it was time to come home. We went back to the airstrip, got in the plane, said turn the key, the motor just cranked, went around and around, wouldn't start. He tried it again, wouldn't start. Several times, just cranking on things, wouldn't start. We started to smell a little fuel, and Sid said, I think there's a vapor lock or something going on here. So we got outside, waited a minute, got back in it, still wouldn't start. And so we're getting kind of nervous, especially me. I said, Sid, it's Saturday afternoon. I got to be back in Cumming tomorrow. I have to preach two services, and I have a funeral Sunday afternoon. I really need to get back. And we were all kind of nervous. But Linda was so calm. She just leaned against the plane and said, well, I guess we could just rent a car. Yeah, just so nonchalant, everything. Just had it all under control. Well, we got back in the plane one more time. Sid tried it and finally started. So we taxied down the runway and took off. And as we're flying back, I noticed the two girls in the back seat didn't put their full weight on the seat. They were trying real hard just to not put any weight down. And me, I'm sitting in the front seat next to Sid, and I'm looking down over all the landscape, looking for a pasture in case we have to land somewhere. Linda was a gift of God to all of us. God provided a wonderful gift for her to us. But David goes on to say, the Lord is not only our provider, but he's our protector, even in death. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, he says, I'll fear no evil, for you are with me. Jesus understands our pain and loss. But listen to his promises. He said, I will not leave you comfortless.
Thank you, Jesus.
He said in the book of Matthew, in the Great Commission, I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. And notice what David says here in the Psalms, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. That means we don't stay there. And when a loved one dies, we have all kinds of language and terms that we use. Sometimes we say, well, we lost them. Maybe you said that, well, we lost Linda today. But you know what? The only time anything is lost is when you don't know really where to find it. We know where Linda could be found today. Safe, healthy, whole, strong, and secure in the arms of Jesus. In 2 Corinthians 5:8, Paul says it plainly, to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. Maybe you've heard the legend of the tall ships, those mighty ships of the 1800s, how the sailors would go down to the dock and they would get on the ship and their family and loved ones would wait on the dock and watch that ship raise its sail and sail out into the ocean. And they'd stand there on shore and watch as that ship went out into the horizon. And eventually the body of the ship disappeared over the horizon. All they could see was the sail. And eventually the sail disappeared. And pretty soon all they could see was the top of the mast. And eventually it disappeared. And those family and loved ones there on the dock turned and they said, well, she's gone. But later, on another shore, a group of people saw the tip of the mast and the sail and the ship. And they said, she's here. On the day that Linda left this earth, we may have said she's gone, but the angels in heaven rejoiced in that very second and said, she's here, she's here. I can't help but wonder. You read through the scripture where Jesus is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. But there are times when you read in scripture that Jesus stands. And in my mind, I can see as Linda came into the presence of God, Jesus stood, applauded, said, welcome. Now, hope we have in Jesus is that he knew death. He knew all about it. He raised many people from the dead. In fact, Jesus experienced death himself, but he rose from the tomb on that third day, and he gave us that same promise. And death is nothing to fear. I love the way one old preacher put it. He says, I'm not afraid of death and dying. Death is simply my chauffeur to glory. It's my ride to the other side. You know, when Linda left this earth, she was not alone. You know what? Neither are you. David says, the Lord is our provider. Secondly, he is our protector, even in death. Thirdly, the Lord is the promise we have of eternal life. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Revelation 21, 3 and 4, John says, now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more mourning, no death, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. In 2 Timothy 4, verse 7, the Apostle Paul says, I have fought a good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearing. Linda lived out that faith and that trust in Jesus, and now she is enjoying that same reward. I never watched many of the episodes of Star Trek, but I found an episode recently about a Klingon warrior named Worf. Worf is captured by a group called the Evil Dominion, and he's used to train as a means of punishment. He's used to train the evil ground troops of the Evil Dominion. What they did was they put Worf in this arena, and one by one, these soldiers, enemy soldiers, came in and would fight him, but he would continually beat them. And one after another, he beat one, the next one would come. He beat him, the next one would come. Hours and hours this went on, and he kept winning. And what he would do, he would pin them down, and they would tap out, you know, like a wrestler would do. And the next one would leave, another one came in. Finally, the commander was so upset with this, he got the biggest, meanest, baddest soldier he could find to send him in to get rid of Worf. And that's what this big, mean soldier tried to do. He punched him, knocked him down, kicked him while he was down. Worf kept getting back up. Even the other soldiers who had been defeated were cheering him on and encouraging him, stay down. Maybe you can have some strength to fight again tomorrow. Stay down. But he wouldn't. He kept getting back up. Finally, you heard the tap, tap, tap. It wasn't Worf. It was this big, mean, bad soldier who had been defeated. When he walked out of the arena, the commander was livid. He wanted some kind of explanation. And this is what the big, bad soldier said. I cannot defeat the Klingon. All I can do is kill him. Friends, cancer said that to Linda. I cannot defeat her. All I can do is kill her. But one unknown writer has said this. Cancer is limited. It cannot cripple love, shatter hope, or corrode faith. It cannot destroy peace, kill friendships, or suppress memory. It cannot silence courage or invade the soul. It cannot steal eternal life, and it cannot conquer the spirit. Cancer could not defeat Linda Fleming. But listen, death could not defeat her either. Christ's resurrection is seen to that.
Amen.
John 11, 25, Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me shall live, even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. It's been said, you can't know the joy of Jesus until you know the Jesus of joy. Linda Fleming did. Today, she's walking hand in hand with her Lord, seeing him face to face. Just think, you're stepping on shore, finding in heaven, of taking hold of the hand and finding it God's hand, of breathing new air, finding it celestial, of feeling invigorated and finding it immortality, of passing from storm and tempest to an unbroken calm, of waking up, finding home. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for the way you provide. You've given us a wonderful gift, Linda Fleming. We've seen how she stood strong, and her faith has passed it on to her family and loved ones. Father, you are also our protector in death, and you are our promise, eternal life. Father, we know that Christians never say goodbye for the last time because of our faith and hope and trust in you, the assurance we have in your resurrection and the promise of eternal life. This is certainly not the one day, and maybe one day soon, we'll all be together again. For that, we give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor.
Yes.
In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Sid and their family, we want to thank you for being here. In all my years of ministry, I hope I've learned one important thing at times like this. I'm going to ask you in just a few moments if you wish to come up and talk to the family. And I've often wondered, what do you say? Well, really, you don't have to say anything. Just the fact that you're here, that you're showing your love and support, means everything. Thank you. You may stand here with me.